Hello and welcome to the Pinken Show live.
Live! How can you prove it's live?
How like this.
Oh, we'll do this.
That really happened.
We'll do that for one.
Live. We'd have definitely cut you off then if that was live. Live! Live on Master. Good old Darren. Live on YouTube and still with our heads just above water after all the comings and goings of a tumultuous week. Down Carrow Road Way. One sacked manager, a range of potential replacements, a whole club restructure on the way, and that's to say nothing of the 2-2 draw with Blackburn, the coming visit of Barnsley, and what happens when the beast goes rogue. There's a lot to get through tonight, and we get through it with our stellar sofa lineup of Little Yellow Bird Project's John Rogers and Richard Jeffrey, and the man who can make any blue chair look good, Darren Eadie.
He's pulled his hamstring doing that little dance.
That was you making it look good. I like that. We're also dedicating more of this show than ever before to your calls, comments and tweets. So please keep them coming in on the Pinker message boards or via Twitter or on the live chat accompanying our YouTube broadcast that will beam you even straight onto my phone here in the studio.
They'd have cut that if it went live, wouldn't they?
Yeah, I think they'd have sacked me, to be honest, if this was like. But before we get to all that, it's time for these. Here are the headlines. Rouse that! Beautiful. Gary Rowett was among the favourites to take over the City hot seat, Mark Warburton too, but these managerial contenders have now been snapped up by Derby and Forest, respectively. So who next for Norwich? Most fans agreed they wanted Alec Neil out, but it's far harder to tell who they actually want in. Start spreading the news. A new Norwich City structure is due to be announced by the end of the week. That structure probably won't be a statue of Alec Neil standing proudly outside the South Stand, shame. But it could be one that includes a new chief exec and or director of football type-ish thing. Times they are changing down at Carrow Road. That's Roy! The rumours about Roy Hodgson won't go away either. Many reckon the former England manager will soon have some involvement with City too, but I'm pretty sure that won't be in the dugout and probably won't be upstairs either. Although there may be a seat in a quiet corner of the boardroom with Hodgson's name on it. And finally, Dyke's head? Was it malicious or was it just mistimed? The last time a Mitchell kicked off like that, the Queen Vic got burned down. So either way, it was a straight red at the EastEnders reference. Nice, yeah. Only Dykes will know whether he lost his head. But one thing's for sure, City have now lost their one and only left back for the next three games. And the beast will be missed. And there we go. There are the headlines. Let's chat, shall we, gents?
Let's talk about Dykes first of all. I think
where
we should talk
do you think that should be the first thing we talk about?
I was chatting to someone today who used to play with Norwich, who's now works for a very, very big football club. And he had Dykes watched. He had Dykes watched for quite a while. And the reason they didn't look at him any further was because of his temperament on the football pitch. Because they just felt he will get sent off at least two or three times a season. Which then you're missing if it's automatic sending offs, 9 games.
I mean, he does like shoving people out of the way. We've definitely seen a lot of that. I mean, can you see, though, what he was trying to do in terms of get his foot across?
John's shaking his head. I could see what he was trying to do. He was trying to hurt someone by pretending he was protecting the ball. It's just in him. He can't help himself. It's just a mentality, and he had that against Ipswich. He was lucky to stay on the field then. I don't mind a bit of tenacity and a bit of fight and a bit of bite, but it's a problem when you're in a team that needs someone like him to be playing every week.
All right, I can't believe we talked about this before everything else, but let's carry on. And then, of course, Alex Pritchard's substitution and the poor facial expression on Alex Pritchard's, face.
Yeah, I mean, we had a little conversation with the people around us about who's going to go, because we knew he was going to be a substitute, because you could see Stephen Whittaker getting undressed.
I know. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Getting ready to come
and then
on.
Dressed again.
Yeah, and then dressed again. But I...
Still live.
Well, it had to be Pritchard for me.
What was Pritchard's face like? I haven't seen it. Show me.
It's a bit angrier than that, I think.
It was pretty
cross. That's the one.
Yeah, like that. I couldn't see he was walking the wrong way as me.
He didn't acknowledge Alan Irvine's handshake when he went off either, did he? He just sort of
brushed past. Yeah. I mean, it was the fact that it was Alex Pritchard, wasn't it? And we've been waiting so long to really see... Well, we just want to see more of him, don't we, ultimately?
I think so. I think that was the frustration that came out in the crowd. I think most people that weren't outraged by it, thought it's going to be Wes or Pritchard's going to go. We're going to get a defender on and have a back four. But it was an odd reaction.
I quickly tweeted out.
They were ready for a shout, weren't they?
Basically. Yeah, I quickly tweeted out, because people were getting really angry. I said, what else would you do?
I saw that tweet.
Did you? Mm. And the only people that came back to me, I thought was good, it was taking Pinto off because he'd just been injured. I spoke to Pinto after the game. Someone stood on his knee, apparently, and it bent the wrong way.
Bad. I was amazed he carried
on. Go three at the back. I could kind of understand that and keep the attacking impetus, but...
I mean, Pinto did finish the game.
Well, and that's the point, isn't it? Because you're playing Blackburn, who were, I think they were third or fourth bottom at the time when the game started. Again, even though you've gone down to 10 men, it was still an opportunity at home to beat them. And it was disappointing not to go a bit more defensive and kind of go that way. But, yeah.
All right, that literally is story enough on the brand. That's the most anyone's spoken about the Blackburn game since it happened. Let's have a listen to some of the fans, shall we? This is from our Pinker match day on Saturday night. These are the fans' reactions from the Blackburn game.
Incredible 24 hours. I think that, as most people, it should have happened long ago. And we're pleased it's happened. The nature and how it took place is really bizarre, but really pleased this happened. In my opinion, let's get somebody in as quick as possible and sift through the players that maybe they want to keep, others that want to go and disappear, and get it sorted as soon as possible. I don't think that should be anybody within the club. It needs to be somebody from outside.
Well, I came as a bit of not a surprise, but it just seemed a weird time of doing it for me, really. You know, we're sort of coming towards the end of the season, sort of out of the playoff race, really. I thought they should have either done it a lot earlier or at least left it till the end of the season, got someone else in who could start fresh then. But we'll have to see how the future goes, really.
Being young supporters, are you pleased that Alex Neil's no longer here? You're a bit disappointed.
Bit disappointed.
Come in, Dad, you don't be shy, are you?
No, I'm glad he's left. Glad he's left. Need someone a bit more Alan Pardew, like, get him in, get us back on the right track and put Norwich where they should be.
And the game again today, I mean, it's 2-2. I mean, it's kind of set by the turn of Dykes, wasn't it? I mean,
yeah.
Is he an accident waiting to happen? It's two or three times this season now he seems to have been...
I actually rate him. I think he's a good player. He's a bit lively, but I think that's what they need. Too many people need to get sacked there on the pitch, unfortunately.
And it's not just on the pitch a lot of people are talking about today as well. And even during the game, they're their anger at the board. So it appears as if just sacking the manager isn't quite enough.
Yeah, well, that's not for me to know, to be perfectly honest. But I think they should, they've done the right thing. They should have got rid of him 5-6 games ago. So we still have a promotion chance. But this season's over, but get someone in and get ready for next year.
So it finishes up 2-2 today.
Legend,
all the talk
before
the game was of the sacking of Alex Neil. You pleased with that initially, I guess?
4 months too late, but yes, I think so. I mean, it's a shame. He gave us the best day of our lives for Norwich fans. But it's been rubbish since then, so...
Yeah, I think most fans wanted to talk about something other than the Blackburn game. Let's have a quick catch-up on the Championship action from the weekend, shall we? All that happened on Friday night rendered all that took place on Saturday afternoon at Carrow Road something of an irrelevance, but let's just have a quick check. As you can see, it was a good weekend for Brighton. Their Friday night defeat for Derby, boosted by Fulham's victory over Newcastle on Saturday. Huddersfield only needed the one goal to secure a win at Brentford, but Sheffield Wednesday hit the skids at Villa, their 2-0 reverse slowing their charge of the playoffs. Which seems to have peaked with their win over Norwich. There were two games played last night as well. Blackburn securing another 2-2 draw away, this time at Fulham, and Brentford going down at home to Wolves. Good comeback there from Paul Lambert's side. So let's take a look at what that means for the bottom of the Championship. Those 2 points from two draws have kept Blackburn... kept Blackburn just about ahead of Bristol City and the relegation places. Above them, Nottingham Forest will be hoping for a slice of Warburton's magic and some good old new manager bounce to pull them further clear at the top. It's all words, really. Are we live still? At the top, it's looking tight again. It's been a long week. Brighton and Newcastle are tied on 77 points. Is that true? Hard to pick a winner, but Huddersfield will be going some to dislodge either from their automatic promotion slots. Further down, Fulham are closing in fast on Sheffield Wednesday in the final playoff place. But Norwich are slipping further back into the pack. They're ninth now, and promotion looks a distant dream. If not, just basically over. Alec Neil has gone, gents. Mm. And the timing. Are we still hung up on this?
I'm more surprised now that it's happened now than I was that that he should have been sacked three or four months ago. The fact he stayed in his job then, I'm more surprised now that he got the sack. Because it was all the talk of we want to build the structure of the future around him and all that. I just thought he was going to be here to the end of the season, without a doubt. So something changed pretty quickly, didn't it, that morning?
Well, that Friday was clearly an incredible day in terms of how things just unravelled. Because as far as I know, even at the start of the board meeting, they weren't expecting it to.
Well, I genuinely believe they went into that board meeting thinking they weren't sure whether they're going to sack him or not. And the decision was made at that meeting. They came out and said, right, let's do it now, without really thinking, actually, who's going to be put in place? Who's going to, you know, and then there's all the whole new structure. What they said by the end of this week, they've obviously given it by the end of this week, so they can actually try and think what they're actually going to do between now and then to how the structure is going to look.
I mean, I got a bit hung up on the timing at the time, but I think it's since become apparent that Alec Neil actually had a part to play in the fact that he did a press conference and then ended up getting sacked. It wasn't like he disappeared and then they told him. So maybe the timing was just a way that things kind of panned out. But I mean, just bizarre timing. In terms of the fact that you thought he would get next season, he was supposed to be rebuilding the club, but I think he wanted to.
I think that's obviously... Maybe that was the plan. Something maybe changed. I think 4 months ago was the time for him to go, to give a new manager time to do what Alex Neil did when he first came into the club, really make a difference, get a couple of transfers in of his men, and change the way the mentality of the squad and get them moving up again. They didn't do that. So you have to think that their plan was to let him rebuild and the 10-year throwaway line that's been sort of pounced upon, but they chose not to do that. So something changed.
It doesn't make you wonder what changed that quickly, that suddenly, doesn't it?
It's interesting that it was that Friday that Alec was talking about his grand plan for what he was going to do over the summer. Mm. That's obviously been speculated too, John. I mean, the board will get criticism from here. They kind of did on Saturday as soon as the fans got the chance to. And is that right?
Yeah, but they're not impartial to criticism. I mean, there has been a lot of changes, a lot from Jez Moxey, from a number of scouting, and you know, head of scouting has been changed so many times over the last few years. This needs a bit of stability, and I think that's what Dilly was saying in that interview in the Times, that 10-year, trying to have some stability. But it's changed again, and no one really knows. There isn't really a footballing person on the board anymore. I mean, David Malley has been in the football. Who is there to kind of focus the board into a decent person?
And that's the worry, isn't it? It's the structure that they're trying to build. It's not just one person, maybe a director of football they bring in. They need lots of people underneath that that have got footballing knowledge within the board and within the structure of the whole football club throughout. That takes a long time to put together. So to say we'll announce it by the end of the week, this new structure, I can't see how a huge amount is going to change. You might get a couple of individuals in, but actually not much is going to change below that and around that.
Well, this is the interesting thing, isn't it? Because I think, by all accounts, we know that there isn't really going to be a chief executive. Maybe someone like Steve Stone will end up being a managing director of some sort. Then you maybe get a football director, a director of football, sporting director, that sort of thing in, and before you start even worrying about the head coach. So who do you want as that director of football role? Because, I mean, that is...
It's a massively difficult one. I think that's someone who tends to be someone who's within the game who actually slides under the radar a little bit. Not a name, not a Roy Hodgson, not someone who's got that kind of knowledge of being a director of football, like we've seen at Southampton, something like that. But for me, they will get the director of football role first before they'll even think about the manager, because then the director of football will say, this is the type of manager I want to work underneath me, and then, likewise, the manager's got to be able to work with them.
It might be common knowledge, but I don't know what a director of football does.
They direct the football.
Oh, they are then? Yeah.
They are. They're the knowledge of football on the board. And we've had a couple of names mentioned
recently.
So he's
a board member.
David Moss, but also helps majorly with recruitment too. So it's like a bridge. We could have gone on that one for a while. We'll come back to it because the show is far from done now. Right, that is us done for part one. When we return, it's all about you as we fire up the phone lines and Supersize Talk is Cheap. See you in three. Here we are. It is Talk Is Cheap. The phones are firing. The tweets and calls and comments have come in thick and fast. We've got a big crown of holds.
You
and
said there weren't any a minute ago. You lied.
They're coming. They're firing in quicker. Magic of TV, Darren. Little Yellow Bird and surely the Housewife's favourite pundit. There you go. I don't know, you figure out which is who between yourselves. You're all on standby, apparently. Yeah. You're all on standby. So let's get the ball rolling with our first caller, shall we? Which is, I believe, James Finbo. James, thank you so much for ringing. What would you like to talk about? The floor is yours.
Cheers, guys. Well, basically, I've long expressed a desire for the club to perhaps look to the continent for a manager. We've seen, like, Watford, Reading, Huddersfield, they've all done this very successfully. And yet I just cannot envisage a time where our current board will go down this route. I was just wondering what everyone would think about possibly pursuing a European manager.
Ask the panel. Go on,
then.
We
were literally just talking about this off air, weren't we?
Indeed.
That exact same thing. And, you know, looking to someone like the Bundesliga, who we've all said is used to working under a director of football, but I just don't think they throw their net as wide as that in terms of managers. I think they let their scouting go out and do a little bit of recruitment a little bit further afield. But in terms of managers, they seem to be very set on British. And I think it'd be a great idea. Why not?
I mean, Southampton kind of do it because, as you said, the managers they're picking in from abroad have worked under the structure they've got in place, which I guess is what Norwich have got to work out, isn't it? Whether they want to pick the people for the structure that they want to be hard and fast, or whether the people they want will be the structure they work around. Chicken and egg.
Chicken
have you got
egg.
Some names, Rich?
I have got a name.
It's hard to keep track of all of European football.
I can't pronounce anyone, so go on.
I mean, firstly, it doesn't matter. I'd quite like to see a foreign manager for a change, but it doesn't matter. It needs to be a good manager. That's what it needs to be. And the guy who's recently available, is Roger Schmidt, who was the manager of Leverkusen. Very highly thought of guy. He was at Red Bull Salzburg prior to that, won the league and the cup in Austria.
You're reading that off your hand, by the way.
Yeah. It's all scrubbed off.
Quick.
He had three seasons with Leverkusen. This season's not gone great. They're mid-table, but he plays the gegenpressing style, very attacking, sometimes a bit crazy attacking, leaves them exposed, but he plays a very exciting style.
We love that football here.
We do.
We love that football here.
And his highly rated coach, Leicester, supposedly interested. Arsenal supposedly were interested in him to come in if Wenger leaves. Let's strike while the iron's hot. Might not happen, but if we don't try.
Well, I think that's the reason as well. Managers, as much as players now, have become commodities. I don't think there are established long-term things anymore. No. To me, the game has changed where they are just as much as a commodity as a player is now moving on.
James, I know you're still on the line. It's remarkable to think Norwich haven't actually ever had a manager from further afield than Ireland, isn't it?
Yeah, I think Hughton, isn't it? Chris Hughton's the only one.
Indeed. Well, Northern Irish, of course. And also note here, maybe Derby are panicking a little bit, which I'm assuming you're referring to in terms of Gary Rowett's appointment this week. I mean, is he someone you'd have liked to see Norwich, you know, get sorted quicker?
Something that I tweeted at the time, basically, a lot of Norwich fans were saying that we're basically the team panicking because we're not getting ahead of teams like Derby or Forest with Warburton. But surely taking your time is not panicking. You know, you don't want to jump straight in for the first manager that becomes available. You know, these managers were both out of work for varying reasons. I think the board are right to get the structure right first behind the scenes and then pick the right manager.
Cool, James. Thanks so much. It's an interest. There's a very interesting line between panicking and being assertive. Well, probably hindsight is the only thing that tells us which works.
I do agree, and I don't in some ways. I think it's if you have an idea on who you want, it's quite relevant to move quickly. But also, you know, I still felt, you know, even up to the Blackburn game, despite after that, there was still an opportunity to pick up plenty of points to maybe even have a chance at the playoffs. Now, you're almost writing that off. They've basically written it off by saying, right, we're going to take our time and get the manager. It's not going to happen. So that fresh face could have all of a sudden got you on a 3, 4, 5, 6 game run. And you might have been in with a squeak. I know it's a tiny squeak, but you might have been.
Well, someone suggested to me that had Alec Neil been in charge on Saturday, Norwich might have beaten Blackburn. Mm. The irony of it. Yeah. We got some live chat people on the YouTube.
Yay!
Straight to my phone. Get your message in. Straight to the phone. Straight to the panel. Lewis Morfitt, I should read these before I read them out, but I'm not. Lewis Morfitt said, we should get a new manager as soon as possible and work our way from there, build the club around them.
That's good, I like that.
But that is actually not isn't it not the entire opposite of what they're going to do?
That's good advice. Well, the thing, everyone's like hailing Derby and Forest as being these brilliant clubs who've got their manager in fast. Forest are inches from relegation, and Derby have had about five managers in the last.
Can I hit you with a stat here?
Go on. Yes, we love stats.
The upcoming East Midlands derby between Forest and Derby County will be the fifth in a row where there's been two new managers in each dugout.
Good. What a stat. What a stat that is.
Love it.
What a basket case, hey, those two clubs. Let's add that injury. Good work, Richard. We can have you on again. So we've got our next caller on the line, which is Tom Osborne, friend of the show, Tom Osborne. Very good looking boy like yourself, Darren.
Well, thank you, Michael.
Are we live? Are we live? Did I just say that?
Thank you, Mike.
Tom, lovely to have you on the show. What have we got here? Shocked, not shocked by Rowett and Warburton's new gigs, which obviously happened very quickly after Alec Neil had been sacked here, and it's not a coincidence, surely.
Tom.
It is live. Maybe hung up after I, you know, called him good looking.
I thought, no, just got to look in the mirror.
What's going on here? Ridiculous. Tell you what, we've got some more messages on the YouTube. David Vincent says, look at Zola. Foreign managers need to understand the championship. That is going to be the big call, isn't it? Whoever would come in, the first question would be, well, they don't get the championship.
There's Wagner's done all right, hasn't he? I think if you're a good football man, you know your football and you know how you want to play the game and structure. Again, that's down to recruitment of the backroom of structure of that football club, making sure they get the right person they want.
But isn't that what the crux of it's not about foreign, it's about what sort of experience they've got. It's just a good football manager. Yeah. That's all we want.
Yeah.
And that
doesn't matter where they're from.
Toss a coin.
Oh. Is Tom back on the phone? Did I hear? Tom!
He is. Hello.
Did you hear any of that before?
I heard selected parts, thank you. Yes, I did. I was very flattered. Thank you very much, Michael.
He heard the important bit, you'll notice there, the important bit. So, Shesh, shocked, not shocked by Rowett and Warburton being picked up very quickly after Alec Neil had been sacked here. What are your thoughts?
Well, when Derby sacked McLaren, I sort of feared the worst. I mean, I'm not saying for certain that Gary Rowett would have been our man, but it seemed like they certainly had a plan, and almost as if they kind of realised that Norwich might be looking for Gary Rowett, so they probably, not feeling too enamoured with Steve McLaren, thought, well, we better sack him quickly if we want Gary Rowett. And I can understand why Rowett did go there. He obviously lives in Derby, used to play for them, so I can see the draw from his point of view. And it was just almost a bit sort of classic Norwich that you see that Warburton and Rowett are the top two purportedly on the list of managers, and they both disappeared to other clubs within a week of Alex Neil being sacked, but there we go.
It does feel a bit like the managerial pot is pretty empty at the minute, doesn't it? Mm. There's not much about, but it doesn't bother me because sometimes if you want the manager, you've got to go and get them from someone. As they did with Alex Neil with Hamilton, you know, if you want someone to go and get them, you have to pay some compensation for them. It doesn't matter.
Well, even Alan Pardew, I think, said you'd never get a management job by interview. No. You literally get approached, and surely it's Norwich's responsibility to know who they want as their next manager before they sack the last one?
It is.
that's why I think that director of football role is so much more important as to what they're looking at before they get the manager in. They're going to be taking all that advice from that director of football as to who they think you should get in.
And likewise, I guess, yes, it's a tricky one, isn't it? And I guess it'll work itself out. But Tom, in terms of what Norwich should do now, I mean, it's interesting one whether a chief executive had been in post, they would have helped Norwich get someone in immediately afterwards. But now that Rowett and Warburton have gone, have you got half a mind to who you'd like to come in?
No, I kind of agree with what Darren just said, really. There's not really many available right now, which is, I guess, not necessarily a bad thing. I just hope that Norwich, the board, do their homework and get someone who's going to be good. I mean, if you look at the likes of what Huddersfield did, they went abroad, they got a really successful number two. They bothered to scout him properly. They, you know, sort of did all the work that they needed, the groundwork they needed to, and got him in, and he's been a roaring success at Huddersfield. So I don't understand any reason why Norwich can't do the similar sort of thing. I mean, I remember the rubbish we had a couple of years ago when they claimed to have scoured all of Europe for the best manager, and lo and behold, it happened to be Neil Adams. And I'm sure a few of us are still in disagreement about that. So it's just whether they can get their houses in order and actually scout properly, because I'm sure there is a young manager out there somewhere who would love to take this job up.
That's the real difference. The structure is not in that football club to look that far afield. That's the worry. And not yet, but it has been quite insular in the way it looks at its football, and I think that needs to change. And they haven't got the people there. Who are they going to contact? They're going to get another agent in to come in and say again, like they just found Jez Moxie. I mean, you can't keep outsourcing stuff. You've got to know the knowledge yourself.
And Huddersfield have got that structure. Huddersfield have got a director of, I think they call him a sporting director. So he's gone out and Wagner's come in from Dortmund, where he was Klopp's assistant. He's used to that system, got great ideas.
We did this system thing once with Peter Grant, didn't we? And that didn't go down well. And we haven't done it since. But it goes through circles, doesn't it? We always kind of try a new thing. We get a young manager, we get an experienced manager, we get an assistant, and it never seems to, as soon as it goes wrong, we never do that again. And just finding the right man and finding a good manager who's going to push us forward. And that's the only thing. It's not about what he can do, like what he has done, about being an assistant manager, being experienced, coming from, that is my point. I think we should just get the right man, go for him. Someone who's in a position right now.
Yeah.
Definitely.
It's hard though, isn't it? Because we would probably say, number twos, they rarely make good managers. And it's interesting, should Norwich in themselves wait if, say, David Wagner became available in the summer? Would that be something that people would accept waiting for?
I think so.
Probably not until they worked it out.
And he's bigger than Norwich already.
Yeah, I don't think he comes to us now. Yeah, that's probably true.
We have had a few names pop along today. Max Gent has been in touch on the YouTube. He says, what do you think about Pearson being touted? Nigel Pearson linked, like Alan Pardew, he'd like the job, he would apply for the job. That's not the same as Norwich wanted.
Why would you want to appoint a manager that's out of work?
No, this is
exactly the reason they're out of work. You know, this is what I've said before. If you're going to get someone, you go out and approach someone who's actually successful for a change.
For a change. Well, someone else, ANCFC, says, Frank de Boer or Martin Yol?
Wouldn't be too adverse to either.
I think, again, maybe we're aiming a bit high with them, but who knows? If you don't try.
Yep. Right, we've got some tweets to have a look at, shall we? I haven't had a look at any of these, so let's have a look at what we've got, what the guys picked. Friend of the show, Dan O'Hagan. All done in less than 48 hours, almost like they had a plan. As I've said, domino effect. As soon as Alec Neil had gone, Derby and Forest made
it
their move.
It does help, though. It does help that he played for the club.
There's no doubt he wouldn't have gone anywhere else. That's gone. There was a lovely tweet there. Maybe we'll see that again in a minute. There it is! Another link to Frank de Boer, 25-1. Obviously, Gary Rowett's gone. Simon Grayson at Preston. Gary Holt, who would love the job himself, but probably wouldn't get it. And obviously, Alan Pardew is top of the betting.
But you know what? I wouldn't take any of those top five, would you?
No, I
want, like the boys have said, I want someone who's going to make me look at it and think, do you know what? That's a shock to me, a real good appointment.
Yeah.
Instead of going,
The same as like Alex Neil was. No way. Where was he on the list? He was never. So I don't think it'll be someone.
But he was a different kind of shock. I want a shock. Look, I'm like a nice surprise.
Happy shock. You want a happy shock.
Alex Neil was a bit like a.
No one wants an electric shock.
I'm sure.
It's like, it was.
We have a very exciting. Oh, you're all right, you two.
Sorry.
We have a very exciting guest on the phone. Former Norwich City striker, Jamie Cureton.
Jamie Cureton,
good evening. Thanks for joining us. How the devil are you?
Not too bad. I'm just getting over the flu, so if I sound a bit deep and husky, sorry. Other than that, I'm very well, thanks.
Amy, get on the lemsip. That's
my old roomie,
You're our roomie, is it? Yeah. I bet you've got some stories.
In digs together. Cool. Well, hours of fun we had together.
We're live on the telly, so we'll save that for the next question. but first of all, Jamie, you're someone who played under Alan Pardew, and I think a lot of Norwich, it's probably a split. Some Norwich fans would love Alan Pardew to come in here as manager. Some are like, I don't think that fits. What was your experience of working under Alan Pardew?
Good, I suppose. I had three very good years under him, personally and as a team. We got to a playoff final, went up the following year, and then got to a playoff semi. So, you know, that was at Reading, where not a lot was expected, especially in the second season in the Championship, and we done very well. And I had my run-ins with him, like I've had with most managers, but I found him good. He was quite ahead of his time. You know, very sort of tactically aware and stuff, and worked hard on the training ground, wasn't afraid to change formations. He's got a bit about him, which I think is why people are probably split on him. But I don't see that as a bad thing. You know, he's got a bit of arrogance and confidence, which I think all good sports people need. So, you know, I've got nothing but, I suppose, good things to say about him. That was a long time ago, so, you know, a lot has changed, obviously. He's gone into different jobs. But I would probably say that you could put up any manager and everyone would be split. I don't think there's 100% that everyone likes one person. But I would see him as a decent option. You know, if they're considering him, then, you know, I would see him as a decent choice.
Is that the difference then? Because it has been a long time since you played underneath him. Has he changed? Has he changed as a person, as a personality? Because you hear lots of things about Alan Pardew. I think when he was up and coming and successful when he was with you, he probably wasn't quite so much as like he is now. I mean, he's going to be expecting big money if he comes here, big money to spend, big money himself. So I think he's probably a very different manager to when you probably played underneath him, is he?
Possibly. I think what he'd done, he's just got more confident. You know, he was still very confident when I worked under him, and he made you feel personally very good and made the team feel good, and it was like we were expected to do well, and he put that out there. And I think all he's done is, as his career's gone on, he's managed bigger clubs, that's just got bigger, and he's got a lot of self-belief, and I think when he manages teams, he expects the best from them and expects them to win things, which I don't think is a bad thing. You know, I think maybe for Norwich it might be nice to have a change and have someone who's a bit more outspoken and, you know, has a bit more about them. You know, sometimes you can be a bit too safe at times, and I don't think his record is too bad. He's got two teams to the FA Cup final, and he's got promotions under his belt from the Championship to the Premier League. So, and he's done well in the Premier League, you know, apart from maybe the last year at Palace. You know, he's kept teams in the Premier League and done, you know, got sort of top half finishes. So, you know, he's done very well. But again, you know, it's down to personal choice and what the board want. And what type of manager and personality they want. And that's what it comes down to.
You played under Jimmy, and there has been a few. Let's be honest. Who was the best you've played under? Is there anybody you kind of think that could be available now? And we're talking before, there's not the kind of managerial pot at the minute seems pretty dry. So you're going to have to go out and get someone from somewhere else. You've played under a lot. Is there anybody you sort of played under and thought, look, would be a good fit for Norwich?
Look at someone like maybe Paul Tisdale. You know, he was linked with Southampton's and Swansea's and turned both jobs down. And he's got that sort of bit about him, a bit of class. He's obviously managing in the lower leagues at the moment, but as an overall manager of what he can do and how he conducts himself, he was very good, very, very good tactically and stuff. And he's someone that maybe would be worth a look, a bit left field. But you have to look sometimes at lower league and see what people are doing. You know, he's been in the job. I think he's probably the third longest serving, maybe second now. So maybe someone like that I would throw into the hat. Like I say, he's been linked with big jobs before and turned him down, and then maybe his career's took a bit of a dive. But he's got Exeter at the top of League Two again, and, you know, like I say, he could handle a big club, definitely, and handle big players. So he's someone I'd throw out there. Phil Parkinson's another one who I've worked with. He's doing a great job at Bolton now. So there's managers out there, definitely. It's just being prepared to have a bit of a gamble and go for one of them. But like I say, it's going to be very interesting because there's not a load that jumped to mind that are not in jobs. So, you know, they need to maybe think hard about it, don't rush, and just hopefully they make the right decision.
Jamie, thank you so much for your call. Go and get well, get that Lemsip down you. And thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. Right, okay then. We've got a couple more names that have come up on the YouTube, guys. The Cowley brothers at Lincoln, done an incredible job, but it'd be a big step. I mean, Jamie talking about Paul Tisdale as well. I mean,
and Paul Tisdale wears a flat cap on the sidelines.
He does, that was my first thought, actually.
John.
Yeah. I like that idea.
The other name is the guy who's going to be coming here on Saturday, is Heckingbottom, ex-Norwich. Did the preview with some of the Barnsley guys who do a podcast up there, and they were so glowing about him, about how he's got the team pulling in the same direction, his man management skills, how he won't settle for second best. And it put me in mind of when Lambert came in, that what he's done for them, he's driven them up the league.
Do you think this group of players they've got the minute, though, needs someone who is got a bit about them, who is a name, for them to react straight away?
I think that part of the problem is the group of players.
Yeah.
And I think there's quite a few out of contract, and they need to get some. And again, I mentioned Grant Holt. Grant Holt came from the lower league, and he had more skill than he was given credit for, but he had passion, he had belief and desire, and he drove that team forward. And we need new blood to do the same.
And I think that will be a change in ethos maybe in terms of what the club bring in. I can imagine that. Mm. We've got our next caller on the line, Andrew Nickerson. Andrew, thank you so much for getting in touch with us. It says here, happy to give the board time to make the right decision. Are you?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we've all recognised there's a lot that needs sorting out. I think they're doing a review. I think it's important to get the right person in charge rather than make a quick appointment and get it wrong.
So, do you have any idea who you would like? I mean, I guess it's you know, there may be other people that become available if, say, Alan Irvine was to take charge of the team until the summer. And you'd be happy with that? Because I guess some people would probably give the board a bit of stick for doing that.
I think it's important to, like I say, to get the right man. I've got somebody in mind who I'd like to see. It's the manager of Fulham, Djokanovic, I think his name is. I think he's done very well with Fulham so far. My reading suggests he's out of contract this summer. Maybe he'd be tempted with a bigger budget. But would we be able to get him before the summer? I don't know. If it means, like I say, getting somebody of that calibre in but waiting till the summer, I think we should do it.
Brilliant stuff, Andrew. Thank you very much. I mean, it's interesting with Jokanovic, Slavica Jokanovic, and Gary Monk, who is also in kind of contract negotiations at Leeds. But
I think he's got bigger fish to fry with Leeds, I think. Yeah. But I look at him in and I just do wonder, look, again, we keep talking half about this manager, but for me, there's such a big problem on the playing staff at the moment. Actually, you could get the best manager in the world at the moment, and I'm not quite sure it's going to work. So there's going to be lots of changes, I think, needed. It certainly needs the right manager, but it's going to need the right manager to change a lot of that squad as well to make it work.
For sure.
Well, we've got a comment on here from James Starling. Thank you very much, James, on the YouTube. Think ultimately whoever takes over needs to revamp the entire coaching team, needs a new fitness coach, defensive coach, tactics coach. Now, we did a Q&A on the thinking of, but it's that coaching, that breaking up of the coaching that I know
you're
a big fan.
Well, it happens at a lot of football clubs now. We haven't done it here so much, but there's specific coaching areas and specific coaches for certain parts of the pitch. I mean, and I could go and coach someone how to be a left back or a defender, but I'm not a left back or a defender. So I could show them the basics, but the actual real knowledge that a defender or a left-back knows is the one who should be teaching that. So specific player position coaches. Simple as that.
It's just as simple as that. Simple as that.
Do it in American football.
They do. Very well.
Yeah.
That and video
and rugby,
replays.
Baseball.
Tweets. We've got two tweets, Darren. We've got two live. Two tweets. What have we got here? Holloway and Hodgson leaving Carrow Road. Oh.
14 minutes ago.
When was that? Well, that's a picture of that. Mm. Could be any time. They have visited Carrow Road. You never know. There we go. Ian Holloway.
There's a barrier up.
And next tweet. Oh, is that you, John? Even on pointless, Ipswich Town are pointless. Yeah, I wonder what the question was.
Look at what company they're in as well. What must be gutted.
Shrewsbury and South End. What do we think the question was?
Who's got the fullest stadium?
Yeah, or how many people turn up on a regular basis, Ipswich?
Beautiful.
I can't add to that.
Okay. It's just too good. What we got here? One more. Stunning Gary off. We cannot pinch any manager whose team is in the top six of their leagues. I mean, that makes a challenge.
Well, you can if you pay them enough money and sell the dream to them of what you're trying to achieve.
Give them the dream.
Sorry. There's going to be three teams. They obviously don't go up from the playoffs. There could be Gary Monk. There's options, isn't there?
Rebuild job. That is us done for Talk Is Cheap. A huge thank you to all your calls, tweets and comments on the YouTube thing. Please keep them coming in future. If you want to do it all over again, remember, we'll be back on the Pinken Show live next Wednesday. If you want to see it all over again, look out for Talk Is Cheap on the Norfolk Now YouTube channel and for the slots it now has on Mustard in its own right. We'll give the phones a break now, but when we return, it'll all be about Barnsley and a last date at Carrow Road for a full 3 weeks. See you in a bit.
Norwich 2, Blackburn 2.
What happened?
Well, apart from our season being well and truly over, the board doing a massive and untested shuffle around, and our manager being sacked with no sign of a replacement.
No, not really.
So let's just focus on the game, shall we? So the game kicked off, and the atmosphere... Oh, made me tingle. Oh, sorry to bother you. Did you just drop your pin? No? Oh, it's you, was it? There you go. Now, it's not very often I can sum up the first 20 minutes of a football game with a noise, but this week I can. Ready? But then Cameron Drome scored.
Cameron Drome, he do a lot of things, but I'll tell you what, he didn't miss those, did he? He didn't miss those.
Even the goal music couldn't be arsed. It was like, na 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 na, I'll do, So there we go, we're 1-0 up, and maybe this is the brand new start that we've all wanted. I mean, Alan Irvine isn't the first choice for everyone, but maybe he's got something, maybe he's got control of these players, and we're starting to do good things, and we could go forward, and... Oh God, Dykes has broken Ender's leg. That's right, Mitchell decided to channel one the Mitchell brothers and did the most red cardy red card I've ever seen at Carrow Road. Luckily, the Norwich crowd aren't fooled so easily. Oh no, most of them decide to boo him for the rest of the game for having the audacity of not being in hospital. Get up, I can't see your tendons hanging out. I don't see any blood, so therefore, I'm going to jeer you unnecessarily for the rest of the game. Boo! So we had no left back, and Alan Irvine decided to make a substitution. So that simple decision that he's made sparked a thought in his brain and produced a series of inspirational talks that he's going to give at Carrow Road later on in the year. You do not want to miss it. Oh, that's right. It's Alan Irvine's How to Shove Your Norwich Career Right Up Your Bum in One Simple Substitution. Don't miss it. So half-time came and went, and with no droning noise to distract the regulars, most of the people kind of nodded off. Until we came 2-1 down, and then, and only then, was the moment we wanted the board sacked. Oh yeah, that's right. We sacked a manager just before a game, and now the crowd want to sack the board during a game. What's next? Yep, that's right. Executions during throw-ins. Only way forward. Cameron Drome scored again, 2-2, who gives a poo? That is what happened. So it's new manager time. And who do we want? So what I've done, I've downloaded this imaginary app onto my phone. I'm just going to press it now. And basically what you do, you put your details in, and it tells you who the ultimate person will take you forward is. It's a very good app. So, let's have a look. We need someone with success, someone with experience, good with people with big egos, that's very helpful. Willing to take a risk, confident, has an eye for talent, tick, tick, tick. And then we can get the best from a younger generation. Let's just see who has come up with. Basically, on that criteria, it is... Will.i.am from The Voice. Oh, I've added the complete knobhead button. Just gonna take that off, start it again. We want Tom Jones from The Voice.
Welcome back to the final part of this week's Pinkin Show Live. John, that was excellent. Look at him, Mick. Yeah. Good work, John. We love them. We love them. Now, we've already put lots to bed so far, but Barnsley still beckon this Saturday. So what will the Tykes make of City's current managerial malaise?
We'll be right back.
What a last stat that is. And so nice to see Patrick Bamford's face.
They were actually some rubbish stats, weren't they, really?
Oh, come on.
60% of managers.
Darren.
Only two went on to win promotion.
You're
not better than that normally.
You're hard to please. Hard to please on that. Does say about the rise of the two, well, the rise of Barnsley, rise of the two clubs, the rise of Barnsley and Norwich's fall. Says a lot, doesn't it? Fall, John.
Well, I think it's all down to Paul Heckbottom, isn't it? I mean, and players that he brought in. I mean, they've lost quite two of their best players, obviously, during the transfer window. And they're still hovering around there. I mean, they love him, I think, Barnsley. They absolutely love him.
Well, it's his hometown club. I know he sort of spent a year at Norwich briefly in the 90s.
He's one of our own.
Well, hey, bring him home, we say. Bring him home. I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? Because he'd be one of those where he has done really well at Barnsley. But even then, if Norwich wanted him, that would be quite a big gamble to see if he could reproduce it somewhere else.
Beat us 7-1, we'll nick him.
A very different group of players as well. And again, we keep coming back to that manager who we want in. Actually, it's important who can deal with the group of players they've got.
But the credit to him for, as John said, Conor Hourihane and Sam Winnell, both going in. So, you know, the two major players in that team, they were pretty decent up at Oakwell earlier in the season. Far too good for Norwich.
They didn't get much money from, did they, really?
No, they've had an issue really adjusting all their contracts and situations since promotion. I think that's why they kind of just effectively walked out. But the fact that he has, everyone expected Barnsley to tail off then, but it hasn't happened. And the manager has to take huge credit for that.
It does to a certain extent. But I just think as well, the Championship's not that great. I think if you've got a half-decent side, you'll do okay at the moment, which is, I think, where Norwich are finding themselves fairly.
I mean, that is a sad indictment of what Norwich have done this year, though, isn't it?
Exactly. You know, Norwich, to this day, I still say, apart from Newcastle's squad, I wouldn't take anybody else's over Norwich.
But he's got them playing as a team,
yeah.
As Huddersfield came and showed what a team plays like, and we have not played like a team. That's the difference.
It's individuals, isn't it?
Mm. I mean, Norwich do always beat Barnsley, apart from last time, obviously.
Can I hit you with another stat here?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
80 years.
Go on, hit me.
Barnsley last won at Carrow Road when the paint was still wet in 1937. 80 years ago.
The last time they played there, wasn't it?
Don't rumour that.
Brian Gunn's 4-0 win still glows above the halls of Carrow Road. I mean, Norwich do have a really good record against Barnsley. So now that you've told me that, Rich, I mean, how worried are we that Barnsley will come here and win for the first time in 80 years?
Does that mean that Norwich are a bogey team for someone?
Yes.
That's good, isn't it? I've always wanted to know what that feels like.
Ipswich as well.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
But still. let's have a look at the fixtures, shall we, for the Championship this week. Here we go. Right, the first time I'm having a look at them. On Friday. Oh, no, this is right. On Friday, Bristol City host Huddersfield, while Reading take a trip to Hillsborough. On Saturday, there's a tasty battle of the new managers brewing, as we mentioned earlier, in the East Midlands, Derby and Forest. And Leeds will be looking to put the brakes on Brighton's promotion push whilst helping theirs at the same time in their 5:30 p.m. kickoff. And don't forget, you can keep up with all the latest from Carrow Road and Colney in the run-up to those fixtures via Sports Extra, pinken.com, and our Norfolk Now YouTube channel. It's the interesting thing with how those fixtures pan out, of course. We have a look at the 11s. The 11s that you would pick if you were in the dugout. Rich, on your Pinken Show debut, here's your 11 for Saturday. Take us through it.
Well, I like John Ruddy. I prefer him to McGovern. I think he's more of a presence in the box. Pinto is our best right back by far. Whittaker, which sums up how bad the recruitment policy's been, we haven't got an actual left back on our books now that Mitchell's Dykes is suspended. So Whittaker has the slot in there. Battle and Closer, I think, are our best centre-backs. All our centre-halves are prone to mistakes, but I think on their day...
That back four frightened the life out of me.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, just would we actually be surprised to see Tim Closer again this season, in all seriousness?
I would be surprised to see him again now, yeah.
If we get a new manager, maybe.
I think that's the only way back. Didn't someone say in the car park they saw him and he said, Alex Neil told him he can find him.
Before the game on Saturday, yeah. Mm. I think while I was talking to the BBC Norfolk boys, yeah. Said Tim sort of said, Alec had told him that was it.
Find yourself another club.
I mean, that's difficult then if you want to recoup a transfer value because you presumably need to keep people in tow. Mm. John, should we have a look at your 11?
Mine's not much different, I don't think.
Oh, dear. Or maybe great. Great minds
think
alike.
It's completely different.
Oh, you little joke.
So I've got
you.
Three at the back. Attack, attack, attack. Yeah. Dream is not over. Christmas tree, etc., etc. Let's go for it. We're gonna get promotion with that team.
Every game.
Every game.
On
we're
in.
Gonna win all the rest of the games, and we'll sneak into the playoffs, and we'll go to Wembley, and it'll be amazing.
Look at that. You think it's on the right wing there?
We'll be there on the Wembley steps.
So Pinto and Josh Murphy as wing-backs?
Yeah, I've gone for wing-backs. I mean, what have we got to lose? Let's try some things. Let's put I think I asked for Jacob Murphy, but it's a big difference, you see.
Switch them up.
Should have put just Jay.
Yeah, I should have. It could have been either. Yeah. Well, maybe this is a good time for... This is serious. It might be a good time for Murphy just to kind of learn his defensive responsibilities a little bit more. I don't know. It's worth a try, isn't it? What have we got to lose?
Why not? I mean, Nelson Oliveira, we'll be hoping. We do have an international break after this week, so there is a couple of weeks then to recoup, but... Getting him back would be a big boost, wouldn't it? Because they missed him.
He's certainly been a plus amongst some turge this season, hasn't he? So I'd be interested to give one reason is to maybe let the players pick the team. See what they fancy playing.
As long as they say so beforehand, because I want to know if they're picking that team. If they all get around. John might be up front.
Yeah, John Rodriguez, I'm up front. Oh, okay, yeah. John. Yeah. Why I'm up front. Then. Okay, off we go then.
a little bit of news from today. We should just add that Norwich's fixture with Brighton in April. I can't remember exactly when it is, but it's now been moved to the Friday for live Sky coverage.
Yeah, I don't know who's doing that.
There it is. Are you doing that one?
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Predictions. We've got about 20 seconds. Darren? And I'm not talking about the cash.
I keep going for a 2-0 win. We're going to get one soon enough, I'm sure. Yeah, 2-0.
2-0.
2-1. 80 years of hurt continues.
Yes. Richard, what a debut. Top work, gents. Well, wins all round. Happy days.
Yep.
Alan Irvine can keep the job for the rest of the season. New director of football. Never moan again. Okay, we're just about out of time for tonight, but it won't be long until you see us again. The Pinker Match Day is back on Saturday evening with all the reaction from in and around Carrow Road once the full-time whistle has sounded against Barnsley. The Pinkin Show proper will be back too live on Mustard and YouTube from 7 p.m. next Wednesday, so please keep those calls, comments and, yes, even those rants coming. A big thank you to John Rogers, Richard Jeffrey and Darren Eadie for their time tonight, and huge thanks to everyone who's played their part on the phones, online, via social media too. As we leave, Norwich still have no manager, no chief exec, no realistic hopes of promotion. But fear not, come the weekend, we should have a whole new structure in place. Let the good times roll. Until then, good night, and Alec Neil will always have Wembley.
It's a knee. It's a knee.
It is a knee. Yeah. Neil Neil. It's Alec Neil's knee, which I think has rendered the whole game
a void.